Sadat, and welcome to Simply Divine. Imagine crushing an object, a really large object, for example, our Earth, down to a really, really unimaginably small size. For example, imagine crushing the size of the Earth down to a size of 1 inch, or maybe the size of a peanut. What would happen? How would the Earth change? Will its property change, or will it stay the same? Well, because crushing an object down to a smaller size causes its density to become higher, the gravity of the object will grow tenfold. For example, if I crush the sun to the size of a house, it will become ten or thousands of times more denser than it actually is. So decreasing a size of a object down to its center of gravity, not really decreasing but more like crushing it, causes its density to go higher. So now that we are talking about black holes, well, at one point, if you crush an object to this particular radius where the object goes into, it will turn into a black hole. This radius is called a Schwarzschild radius. Every object in the universe which has mass or density, once crushed to its Schwarzschild radius, will become a black hole. And for each different object, there's a different Schwarzschild radius, and we have a formula to calculate what is the Schwarzschild radius for a certain object. So our Earth or our Sun, it would be very hard to crush an object like that small, with that less density, that less gravity, to down to the size like I said before. But stars which are way, way, way bigger, 10 or 16 or 70 or maybe even 80 times the size of our own Sun, or 80 solar masses as scientists said, those stars are so massive, so dense, and so much mass in them that they can be easily crushed into the Schwarzschild radius, and the Schwarzschild radius is quite big. For example, stars which are around 10 times the size of our Sun, well, those stars don't stop at their carbon stage of their nuclear fusion. Main sequence stars like our Sun, these stars, once they reach carbon, they don't have enough gravity or enough size to crush carbon into its next stage, stopping the outward force. And because there's not enough gravity, because of no enlargement, the gravity becomes very weak and it's not able to hold the star together, and just all of the star just radiates away, leaving a very hot core. But bigger stars, like I said, those stars have enough gravity to crush carbon into its next form. For example, nitrogen, the neon and oxygen, and finally when it reaches iron, what even if fused does not create any energy and is too heavy to be fused, so it's basically nuclear ash and is probably useless for fusion. So because there is no thermal pressure or the outwards force, and there's no enough amount of inwards force, so there's no equilibrium between the outwards and inwards force, without the presence of the outwards force, the inwards force, the gravity which has been building up the whole time, all of a sudden just crushes the star into itself because there's nothing stopping it. Now the entire gravity of the star all of a sudden reaches the core and it's trying to crush the core. What happens here is that the electrons and protons, two negative and positive forces, get crushed into each other and turn into neutrons. But at this time, there's what we call a neutron degeneracy pressure happening in the core. There's a law that states that two elementary particles, like for example electrons, should not be in the same quantum state. But because of this pressure, that's what the gravity is trying to do. So there's this against force against the gravity called degeneracy pressure, which is trying to stop the gravity from crushing the core into itself, which most of the time will stop the gravity, and the core, which is full of neutrons, turn into a neutron stars, which are really bizarre objects and deserve a video of its own. But sometimes in stars around 20 times the solar masses of our own Sun, these stars have so much mass in them that not even these quantum mechanical forces can stop them from collapsing into itself, causing the entire gravity of the star going down all of a sudden in a microsecond to a size of an infinitesimally small point called as a singularity. Now, I might have heard in geometry that a point is an object with no breadth, width, weight, or length. The same thing is this singularity. Singularity is basically a geometrical point with infinite density, infinite mass, and an infinite amount of gravity. This singularity is probably the heart of a black hole. And this is the reason that black holes look black and they have so much amount of this mass. So, around the singularity, there's a point called an event horizon. What's an event horizon is basically, it's a place which once crossed cannot be returned. In an event horizon, whatever happens after the or inside the event horizon cannot be seen. The singularity is inside the event horizon. So we are actually never able to study a singularity because the event horizon is always covering it. After the event horizon, the singularity's gravity is too strong to let anything pass away from it. Not even light can escape once across the event horizon. And what if there are objects that are faster than light? But that's actually impossible. According to Einstein, C equal to mc square, no object can go faster than light. It will just have not enough mass. It won't have enough energy. We need to keep giving it energy. And since speed of light is like a speed limit for the universe, that means that absolutely nothing, and I mean nothing, can escape a black hole once it enters a event horizon. We can maybe say that quantum particles or maybe virtual particles can escape from an event horizon, but that's a completely different topic. And quantum mechanical forces are a completely different universe itself, and they follow a quite different amount of physical rules. So we have the event horizon and we have a singularity. Now you might have seen in many of these black hole photos, which by the way are mostly artistic portraits, there's only one really done photo of a black hole, and that's very recent, but we have never actually made a photo of a black hole other than the one we have already done. They're really hard to do because they don't emit that much light and they suck most of the light that are received to it. So it's a very hard process to take a photo of a black hole. Outside the black hole, in most photos you would have seen that there's this very hot piece of plasma going around it. Well, that's exactly what it is. It's a piece of plasma just circling around the black hole in a very high speed. Because sometimes when a black hole encounters a star, it sucks the star's outer plasma and it just starts revolving around the black hole, creating these very beautiful, huge and very hot pieces of stellar mass circling around it. Most black holes, or the most commonly found black holes, are stellar mass black holes. These black holes are the ones you might have seen the most, or the ones that are mostly commonly noticed or found, because these black holes are probably everywhere. Whereas stellar mass black holes, the one I said with the plasma rings around them, these are most of the time only found in the center of galaxies, since those places are filled with very, very, very hot stars and plasma. This place in our own Milky Way, the center of the galaxy, is called the central hub. And there it's filled of stars and planets, and there is our own supermassive black hole called Sagittarius A star. So that was a short thing about black holes, and if you want to know more, you just please stay tuned, because this is the first video of my 3-part series I'm making about black holes. Till then, thanks for watching.